Well, good morning, and thank you for joining us for our Wednesday Coffee Time with God Bible study. We're going to continue with our study of the book of Judges. We're going to be in chapter 2, and we're going to go through verses 6 through 15. And this will cover, today we'll cover the death of Joshua, you know, the one who led them into the promised land and had such strong, sure faith in who God was and what God was able to do. And then also we'll talk a little bit more about Israel's unfaithfulness. So we'll start in verse 6, and again, I'll put the scriptures up on the screen, but go ahead and get your Bible so you can read along with me in the Bible that you're familiar with reading. I want you to learn your Bible and be able to navigate it as much as possible. Starting in verse 6, we read, "When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And then Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gosh. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work he had done for Israel." So those first few verses of Joshua chapter 2, 6 through 10, we'll go over the rest of them at the latter half of the study. But we see that Joshua is 110 years old. He's passed away. And then we see that every elder that was part of Joshua's generation, that would be with Joshua and Caleb, that generation, once all of those elders passed away, then arose another generation. And it describes this second generation as a generation that did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel there in the last part of verse 10. So this generation didn't know, they hadn't experienced the faithfulness of God. If you remember the stories, Joshua and Caleb, they saw God do a whole lot of things, and that generation saw God do a whole lot of miraculous things. Now this new generation, one of the only things that they had ever seen God do was take them into the promised land. And so here, they're in there, and as far as they know, Joshua is great. They win every battle, they fight. They're a force to be reckoned with, right? But we learned already from our study in Joshua that they never really obeyed the Lord completely in what God asked them to do. And as we apply this to our own spiritual lives, we learn that this is not something that we're unfamiliar with either, that we're all plagued with this notion of I know what I'm supposed to do, but I don't do it completely. I know I'm supposed to cast off the sin that's hindering me, but what I do is I, instead of casting it off, I kind of tie it up and put it in a corner, and then foolishly we go and untie it every once in a while so we can play with it, and then it takes over, and then we're like, oh no, this is awful. So we tie it up again and put it in the corner and walk away from it, but we never cast it away. We keep it. We keep it around in ways that we shouldn't. And that's what the children of Israel did here. And that's the application for us. And for us to think, you know, once that generation that saw the goodness of God passed away, this generation that hadn't seen what God could do, no longer trusted in him, no longer put their hope in God, no longer walked in righteousness. And as people, we sometimes do the same thing. And so, reading verses 11 through 15, it says, "And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and served the Baals, and they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers." So it's Israel that's leaving, okay? Just keep that in mind. "The God of their fathers who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after the other gods from among the gods of the people who were around them and bowed down to them. and they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. We'll get back to that in just a second, but continuing on with verse 14. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies, so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. And whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them for harm, as the Lord had warned, and as the Lord had sworn to them, and they were in terrible distress. So back up to verse 13, it says, they abandoned the Lord, and they served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. And these two, Baal and Ashtaroth, they were consorts. They were together, and they represented not just fertility for people, but even for the land and the soil. So these were the gods that you would worship if you wanted abundance, if you were looking for sustenance, in much the same way that we in our modern age worship the gods of finance and the gods of entertainment and popularity and fame, these things that make us feel important and make us feel stable. That's the same gods. One was a very seductive goddess. The other was this god that you worship through child sacrifice in order to make certain that you had a good harvest in your yield. You would even give up your children in order to maintain that good harvest. And families today do the same thing. We oftentimes sacrifice our own children on the altar of financial gain or even on the altar of fame. Generations of people have done this, and that's not who we're called to be as believers. We're called to train our children in the ways of righteousness. We're called to watch after them. We're called to lay our lives down for their behalf and for the behalf of our neighbors as well. Just the opposite of what the Baals and the Ashtaroths required for worship or promised in worship. The Lord says, no, you'll serve me in both righteousness and honor and doing the right things and casting off sin, and then I will take care of you in the way that you need to be taken care of. But they chose to abandon the Lord there in verse 13 and go after those gods that were a little more self-serving, that were a little more about them, I guess you could say. But then there it says in verse 14 that the anger of the Lord was kindled against them. It's just not good to ever have God against you. You know, if the scripture that says if God is for us, then who could be against us? And the implication being that no one could be against us if God is for us. And yet what we see here in verse 15 is one of the most disheartening pieces of scripture that you could ever read, where it says, whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them. So every time they went to war against the enemy that had been plundering them, that God was actually not on their side. He was actually against them, which is a bad position to be in. And so again, here the application for our own spiritual lives. Have you ever found yourself going in a direction that God is opposing? And a lot of times he'll let us continue pushing in that direction, even though he's opposing us, and things start to fall apart, family dynamics start to fail, because you're walking in disobedience to what you know God wants you to do, and he opposes you. And when God is opposed to something you're doing, you're not in a very good situation. He will do things in order to hinder you. He'll do things in order to get your attention. He'll do things to mess up your plans so that they don't work the way they're supposed to, because he has a will, he has plans that he has laid out for you that he would like you to continue to walk in obedience rather than disobedience. And disobedience never turns out well for the children of God. We need to seek obedience. And the final words there of that verse where it says, and they were in terrible distress. Just this notion that everything was not what God had promised them, and they would cry out to God at this point. They would say, oh God, where are you? And we'll talk about that more next week, where they start to cry out to God for help. And God continues to be faithful throughout the time of the judges. But what we're going to see in the book of Judges is Joshua has passed away, and Joshua was at the very top the best that God could find in the nation of Israel. And by the end of the book of Joshua, there's a famous phrase that says Ichabod, which means the glory of the Lord has departed. You know, it just means God has left the building. And by the end of Joshua, that's the state that we find ourselves in, where it's just like, oh, you know, had an Old Testament professor that described it as a bucket that had holes drilled in the bottom because of the lack of obedience and relationship with God. And the water just slowly drained. And so the best that God could find in Israel was down here. Not someone that we would even think of as a biblical hero, but he was the best that God could find in the whole country. And we see the level of the judges go down a great deal by the time we finish the book. And so we're going to look at some of these stories of these judges as we go through here, knowing that none of them are ever going to be Joshua. None of them are going to reach that caliber again. And we will, you know, maybe when we see King David show up, but again, this is long after the time of the judges. But when we see King David, we see a different kind of man in King David. And even though he had his faults, even though he messed up, he had found that key of intimacy. He had found that secret place to go and hide with God, which is what you'll see all of these folks kind of stumble upon God. But David went and sought God out, kind of like Joshua did. Joshua didn't stumble upon God. Joshua went hunting for God. He went and he remained in the tent of meeting, as we talked about last Sunday in worship. And this whole notion of seeking intimacy with God is something that God's calling us to. So we're about to go through the book of Judges, where we see that just the opposite takes place, where people are not seeking the face of God. They're seeking their own. And we'll see the horrible consequences of seeking to do things our way in the comfortable way and making things about us instead of serving God and making it about God. And so we'll learn about that in the coming weeks. And we'll probably zip through some of the next chapters a little bit faster than we have been. But I wanted us to get a really good foundation of what the book of Joshua, or Judges rather, is about, so that we're not confused about what the purpose of this book is. It's just an excellent schoolmaster for us if we want to embrace this life of being a disciple of Jesus Christ. A lot of the judges, while they're used by God, they teach us a great deal about how not to go about it. And then when we get into the life of David later, then we will learn, okay, this is how David kind of broke the mold of the way things had been going. And we're going to start to apply those to our lives as well. So until then, I'll see you next Wednesday. Maybe you'll join us tonight for our Wednesday evening Bible study. And I look forward to seeing you whenever I can.